Welcome to Internet Protocol with Tish. I'm Letitia Mile. Let's face it, creating effective parental controls can drive us all nuts. The obvious goal is to keep your kids away from a lot of the garbage that's all over the internet. But be too aggressive, and you could virtually choke access to sites that young kids could visit for school projects or homework or just for fun. Usually, when you talk about parental controls, the old adage, better safe than sorry, comes to mind. But I'd also add the words, be realistic, to that. You have to walk a fine line between being extremely overprotective, yet not squelching your kids' curiosity and creativity. And that's a tough balancing act. Both the Windows and Mac operating systems offer a decent amount of parental controls. But are they enough? Check out these statistics compiled by the Surveil Star website. 90% of kids aged 8 to 16 have viewed porn on the internet while doing their homework. 1 in 5 children aged 10 to 17 have received a sexual solicitation over the internet. And about one-third of young people surveyed, that's 34%, admit to regularly communicating online with strangers. Listen to what one of our viewers had to say when his preteen daughters went online at a friend's house where no parents or parental controls were in place.
When my daughters go over to other people's homes, I'm afraid of what they're exposed to on the internet without their friends' parents being around. Case in point would be when friends of theirs got onto one site. It was called Chat Roulette, and it's apparently a website where you get on there and you can chat with people all over the world, if only for a few seconds at a time. In theory, it's a good idea, but interspersed throughout all that is some pretty seedy stuff that preteen kids do not need to be exposed to. And they in fact were exposed to it, and it was it can scar a kid at that age. And that is one of the reasons why I insist on parental controls in other people's homes, and not just the kind that are provided via the internet. I'm talking about actual parental controls by the parents.
One thing that's important to remember while planning your parental control strategy is that kids are tech savvy, and they'll eventually find a way around whatever parental controls you install on that computer. You really have to stay one step ahead of them, and that can be hard to do. Deputy James Spurlock is with the Loudoun County Sheriff's Office in Virginia. Deputy, how serious is it for kids to accidentally or intentionally stumble into the wrong website?
It can be very serious. Because of there being so much cross terminology and so many different meanings for the same word, when a child does a search online, they very well might be looking for the right thing, but it might not be what they're finding. Those first couple of things that pop up, when you do a word search, you do use a search engine, things that come up are based on popularity. So depending on how that term's used and what's most popular with that term, it may not be exactly what that child's looking for.
What are some of the key features then that parents should look for in the parental control devices?
There's lots of different software out there that can be added to the computer. There's no 100% software. I wish I had a better answer than that, but I hear from parents all the time, they've gone out and they purchased the best version of this, or they've downloaded the best version of that, and in a matter of weeks, they catch their kids on websites that were supposed to be blocked. A lot of that has to do with, once again, this YouTube generation with our current technology, with our young people. They learn from each other, and all it takes is for someone to learn that back door to get around that, and it goes onto YouTube, and they're teaching everybody else how to do it.
Beyond parental controls, are there any other online resources parents can turn to on ways that parents can stop their kids for intentionally or inadvertently getting to these problematic websites?
The National Center for Missing and Exploited Children has a great website that covers a huge diversity of age groups. They have stuff for smaller kids, stuff for your tweens, stuff for your high school age kids. They have stuff for adults. And every one of them is specifically written for that age group. It's not just throw one informational program at everybody and see who it's going to stick to. They custom tailored these different blocks for the appropriate age groups.
Deputy Spurlock, thanks for joining us on Internet Protocol.
Tessa Jolls is the president of the Center for Media Literacy. And Tessa, your position is that we not necessarily filter out what the children are viewing on the internet, but instead give them better ways with which to understand the content that's coming across. Could you explain that?
Yes, definitely. Certainly, there's no substitute for parenting, and so it is important for parents to set limits and boundaries for children with media. But at the same time, it's really critical that children acquire an internalized kind of filtering system for themselves so that they can think critically and make good choices about media.
What are some of the things that you can tell a parent to help the child manage the content?
Well, definitely ask the right questions and teach children to ask questions about what they're watching. So questions such as, why is this message being sent? Or who sent this message? Or what techniques are being used, that makes you want to watch this? So there are some questions that we can definitely make children aware of that will help them to, quote unquote, see the media differently.
We talked with one parent whose child was going over to someone else's house, and those parents weren't putting in filters on the computer, allowing his daughter to see inappropriate content that he deemed inappropriate. So how do you go around that, or how do you cut through that, or how do you help the child navigate that type of stuff, especially specifically porn, I guess we should be saying?
Yes, and that's a common problem, unfortunately. The best thing is for a parent to continue to express their own values about media. So in other words, if a child says, say, I played a really violent video game at my neighbor's house, well, then it's important for the parent to really say, well, look, let's talk about that and raise some questions about that experience, and also state about how the parent doesn't think that that's a healthy kind of experience.
Tessa Jolls, thanks for joining us.
You're welcome.
So let's just get right to it. Let's write some guidelines right now, some internet protocol about choosing the right parental controls for your situation. Parents, educate yourselves. Some websites have sneaky ways to lure your kids. Some intentionally change spellings of keywords that kids can safely search, like spelling the word sex with a dollar sign, or by spelling porn as P-R-O-N. Kids quickly learn about these misspellings and use them, effectively bypassing parental controls. You can't let your guard down. Be aware that there are no foolproof parental controls out there. And just make sure that you're clear with your kids about what your morals are and what your expectations are. Also, remember, in many places, kids do not have legal rights to privacy until they're at least 18, so use that to lay down the law in your own home. Bottom line is that parental controls give parents control. Talk openly about what you will and will not let your kids see on the internet and what's off limits. They'll always be ahead of you when it comes to innovative ways to work around those restrictions, but you shouldn't be far behind. Effective parental controls should work at the application level and at the system level, meaning that you should not forget about the parental controls built into your PC or Mac's operating system. These are generally all or nothing types of parental controls. They switch on or off browsers, control ports reserved for IMs and chats, and even may monitor content to make sure it fits within your prescribed guidelines. System level parental controls have come a long way, but they still have a long way to go. So don't rely on them exclusively to keep your child away from the darker side of the net. Do your homework before selecting the parental control software package that's right for your family. Another thing to look for are time restrictions. Do the parental controls you're considering allow you to set time parameters on various computers? This way, you could grant your kids computer access during the hours that you're home from work, for example, but limit access when you're gone. And we need to say this again. Don't overdo it with excessive parental controls. Don't make them so restrictive that your kids can't do their homework or research or even have a good, clean fun online. You should tweak your parental controls over time as your kids mature and as your trust level grows. And remember, although it's hard to believe, there's a lot of good stuff out there on the internet, content that really is okay for your kids. The internet is a powerful resource and can add a lot of fun to their lives, so try not to go overboard on limiting their access across the board. There you have it, Internet Protocol on Parental Controls. Thanks for joining us on this edition of Internet Protocol with Tish. We look forward to seeing you next time.